Welcome to SNS, Curtis Ravenel, member of the Task Force on Climate-Related Financial Disclosures. Tell us about this, the work of the Task Force.
So the Task Force is an industry-only led organization. It was convened by the Financial Stability Board, which is an arm of the G20, and the Financial Stability Board is made up of all the central bankers of the G20. And they were asked to look at climate-related risks in the financial system. The task force itself is not designed to determine whether or not there is risk in the financial system, but rather to elicit information from the financial community on their exposure to highly carbon-intensive industries. The idea is that if there is a successful transition to a low-carbon economy, or even if there's not and there's increased physical risks, what is the potential exposure? And if the investors have the right information about their investments, that they will be better stewards of capital and hopefully be able to assist in what we would call a smooth transition to a low-carbon economy rather than an abrupt one. The Financial Stability Board was created in response to the financial crisis of 2008, and they don't want that to happen again. And there's some worry that there could be contagion if assets are repriced, heavy policies come in reducing the consumption of carbon assets. And so the market is a great mechanism for really properly pricing information if it's given all the adequate information it needs to make that determination. So in the end, we're trying to elicit disclosure that talks about companies' resiliency in this turbulent time. Should we transist or should we not? There'll be different kinds of risks will be exposed, and they're asking companies to look more forward thinking. I think traditional financial analysis looks at a snapshot in time and looks at historical performance. Mm-hmm. Given that this is a longer term issue, we're really talking about creating a paradigm shift in the way that we think about financial performance and trying to look more forward instead of backwards.
Okay. So what are the main recommendations?
The primary recommendations are things that most companies have seen before. Mm-hmm. They're structured in a way. We realize that climate risk is one of many risks. Mm-hmm. There's cybersecurity risk, there's terrorist risk, there's all kinds of different risks. You don't want to make it a special type of risk. You want to integrate that risk into existing processes. Senior management and board level people are already very busy with their day-to-day jobs and managing all of the different aspects of a business. So we designed the recommendations to talk about governance, strategy, risk management, and then metrics and targets. And those could be widely applied to all sorts of issues. So it's not a specially designed protocol, but rather one that looks at climate specifically and says, how do we think about climate in terms of traditional management systems? And how do you elicit that kind of information? I'd say the primary anchor innovation of the task force is really the elevation of the issue of scenario analysis. Mm-hmm. Oil and gas companies have been doing this for a long time, looking at future. When you're making long-term capital investments, you need to plan for possible future states. The Paris Accord aspires to reach a 2-degree or below world. And in order to do that, we're going to have technology interventions, political interventions. There'll be some transition market risks associated with those, reputational risk, and then there's, of course, acute and chronic weather. So increasing storms, that would be extreme weather event, which would be acute, whereas, say, water resource depletion would be a more chronic event. And I think the theory is that while many companies and investors are thinking about these issues, many, many more are not. Mm-hmm. And that they really needed some guidance on how to think about mm-hmm. these issues. And how to disclose them. And that's what the framework provides. It is voluntary, and it was led by industry only. And so you had all of the major industries and all of the major financial institutions from around the world, a mixture of representatives from those G20 countries, come together and reach consensus on a recommendation. And I assure you that consensus was hard fought. And so we think that the recommendations are aspirational but achievable. And we think it's a balance between what's really needed in the marketplace and what's really doable by the companies. There's still plenty of work to be done, but we think we've started, elevated the issue to senior management level, and we're beginning on a pathway. And it will take industry's leadership, continued leadership, to take these recommendations and really make them applicable.
Final question. How has these recommendations been received by different stakeholders?
Well, as you might imagine, this is a very hot button issue. Mm-hmm. And so different stakeholders from different regions and different industries around the world have responded differently to it. I would say overall, the response has been much more positive than we thought. And again, it has been about starting a dialogue and beginning to think about these things in a way that we haven't thought about them before. And so there's still a lot of work to be done. What we do not want this report to do is to sit on a shelf collecting dust. What we want it to do is to be an impetus to begin thinking about future states and what a future world might look like. And for this to be as much about risk as it is about opportunity. You could argue that the dollars needed to invest in a low carbon economy are significant, and as a result, it's going to be a big economic opportunity for many, as much as a risk management. It's important to look at both sides.
Thank you.
Thank you.